This one here, cyclophotocoagulation, is considered to be minimally invasive, so technically it fits in what we call the MIGS criteria, minimally invasive glaucoma surgery. Now you may all recall the photocoagulation of the ciliary body that was done externally, and that was a very painful procedure used only for end-stage glaucoma because it was completely untitratable, right? It either worked so ridiculously well that you ended up with a ticicle eye, or it didn't work at all. So it was really the older style ciliary process ablative procedures was really just for treating pain, you know, truly end-stage blind painful eyes. Well, fortunately, we now have an endoscopic technique. It's pretty cool. Let me show you. We've got a video of it here. So this is an animation of the procedure. Generally, it's done after cataract surgery. It's endoscopic, so you can see you've got this on the monitor up here, and you can see as the animation essentially just fries these ciliary processes, and they just shrink, right? And the whole purpose is to ablate or destroy the ciliary processes which are producing aqueous. So if you can't get the aqueous to drain properly, the other option is, well, let's keep the aqueous from being produced. A couple of issues, as you might anticipate with this, is how do you titrate it? You know? And nobody really knows. This procedure here, the endocyclophotocoagulation, ECP, is hard to titrate. If you don't get enough of these ciliary processes, essentially, you know, nothing happens. You get no result. If you get too many, which fortunately with ECP is hard to do, it's hard to get too many, then you could end up actually with hypotony. The real issues with ECP is that there aren't that many studies out, so we really don't know how well it works. It seems to be pretty effective for mild to moderate glaucoma. It's a good procedure for patients who are having cataract surgery or have already had cataract surgery, because as you can see, you have to place this this probe here between the iris and the lens in this sulcus. If you've got a natural lens, you're going to ding it. You're going to end up with a cataract. So this isn't something that you do in a phakic patient. The other issue is that you've got to shrink these processes, but you don't want to get them to the point where they pop. And they're a bit like popcorn in that, you know, they'll shrink and then suddenly they'll pop. And if they pop, you've just created a huge inflammatory reaction, which can be quite troublesome. And you can actually end up with significant pressure spikes. Then the last thing is, it's not cheap. You have to get your surgery center to be willing to spend I think this is about a $40,000 to $60,000 unit. It depends on what kind of deal that you can work, but most surgery centers just aren't willing to invest in this. So then along comes trabectome. Now this is kind of an interesting procedure, because with pediatric glaucoma, what you do often is you'll go in with a device and you'll rip open the trabecular meshwork, right? So you call it a goniotomy or trabeculotomy, depending on what approach you take. But in adults, it doesn't work so well. And there are a number of reasons for that. But one of the reasons is that we scar down. So you open up that trabecular meshwork, you've got Schlemm's canal, the anterior chamber, but those two leaflets of the remaining trabecular meshwork tend to zipper up, and then you lose your effect. So with trabectome, what was done was a probe was designed that essentially creates a small little plasma. And these electrodes are passed into the trabecular meshwork. It ablates the trabecular meshwork in such a way that, in theory, less scarring occurs. Now, this is another one of those procedures that is generally only done with cataract surgery or after cataract surgery, because you're passing this probe across the pupil. And if you ding the lens, you're going to ding it in the center, you're going to get a cataract. So it turns out that this procedure gets the pressure into the upper teens. So for somebody with mild to moderate glaucoma, it can be a nice procedure to offer. So it does, however, limit future surgical options. Okay, you've just ablated the trabecular meshwork. So any future surgical option that requires that you have a patent canal or trabecular meshwork is no longer an option. Now, why is that important? Because I'm going to go over a number of procedures that are newer procedures that require that.